This audiobook is distributed by Christian Audio. Please visit christianaudio.com to offer your impressions of this work and to explore additional titles.
This is a presentation of Crossway Audio. Welcome to the audio version of Rescuing Ambition, written by Dave Harvey. Rescuing Ambition is published by Crossway, a publishing ministry of Good News Publishers of Wheaton, Illinois, all rights reserved. This book is read by the author. We begin now with the introduction, Ambition's Face.
Welcome to the introduction, though why should I stop my busy life to start reading this section? An extensive survey, meaning the one I conducted by walking around my office and asking a few people, has conclusively proven that people rarely read introductions. So thanks for bucking the trend. Let's tackle the curiosity question delivering you here in the first place. Why should you, with so many demands already hijacking your time, read this book? Let me answer that question in a manner befitting a pastor. Cue the story. For the past couple decades, I had a condition that kept me from sleeping well. The technical term was apnea. My wife called it snoring like all get out. So I went to see the doctor. "I'll remove your uvula," he said. "Then you won't snore. You'll sleep better." Now, I didn't even know I had a uvula, but I freaked when he suggested its removal. There's something about doctors' scalpels and stitches in the throat area that makes one more content to go without sleep. For some reason, though, I let them do it. They cut out my uvula, and now I can sleep. But here's something I didn't expect. When I lost my uvula, I found my dreams. You see, because I never slept well, I never dreamed. I know experts would say I dreamed and just didn't know it, but that doesn't matter because I don't even remember dreaming. Not once. I was dreamless. Even an expert will tell you that's a boring way to spend a night. I didn't even know I'd lost my dreams until I found them. Or, rather, they were returned to me. Actually, they were rescued, airlifted from some cold, lifeless crevice where dreams hibernate until the arrival of deep sleep. Or something like that. All this may sound strange, but it's true. My dreams were rescued by a guy with a scalpel. Go figure. Lots of people live that way, you know, without dreams. They move from one day to the next without the refreshing effect of a memorable dream. I can relate. My lack of dreaming was never bad enough to disrupt my life, just enough to turn my nights into slow motion and make my days hazy, like a mist fogging my mental windshield. But there are dreams we can lose that are much more significant than those I was losing. Not the REM kind of dreams, but the dreams that drive us when we're awake, the dreams that cause us to reach beyond ourselves, to see beyond the present, and to live for something more. If you're having trouble holding on to those types of dreams, that's a real problem, and this book is for you. The Most Secret Passion. My friend Andy is a gifted man who grew up with little drive to develop or use his gifts. Be all you can be? Nah. Ambition for Andy was like algebra. He needed enough of it to pass, but any more than that wasn't worth the trouble. Andy preferred a good nap to a new challenge. He didn't have many dreams, or he'd lost the ones he had. In college, Andy was converted to Christ. His life was no longer his own. He realized that his fruitfulness as a Christian was linked to his dreams and desires for God. Over time, Andy's eyes were opened to dreams he'd never had, aspirations for the glory of God. That changed Andy as a man, a husband, a father, a Christian. He saw the connection between dreams, the right kind, and enjoyment, fruitfulness, and glorifying God. That's quite a connection. Those are the kind of dreams I'm talking about in this book. They stir one of the most potent motivations of the human heart, ambition. It's the instinctual motivation to aspire to things, to make something happen, to have an impact, to count for something in life. Herman Melville called ambition the most secret of all passions. What do you call it? What comes to your mind when you think of ambition? Does the word conjure images of megalomaniacal petty dictators or chew-up-anybody-in-my-way corporate climbers? Or do you see ambition as an important part of great human achievement, the drive behind scientific discovery, political change, artistic excellence? More importantly, do you see it as something occupying the interest of God? Do you know what comes to mind when I think of ambition? Me. I've always had more of it than I knew what to do with. If it involved a ball, I wanted to be on a winning team. If it involved a group, I wanted to lead. If it involved school, I wanted to leave and go play something with a ball. Yeah, my ambitions were strong, but they ran pretty shallow. From early on, I remember wanting to make an impact, to differentiate myself in some way. Give me the ball, give me the lead, give me the wheel. It didn't matter. I just wanted to be somebody creating momentum. And if, in some strange and totally unexpected way, my actions brought attention to me, then bring it on, baby. John Adams once spoke of the natural passion for distinction we all have, how every person is strongly actuated by a desire to be seen, heard, talked of, approved, and respected. I'm not saying this is a good thing, but it sure was a Dave thing. Being first wherever I may be was an unconscious mantra I repeated with religious fervor. And it's that very struggle with ambition gone bad that led me to write this book. Maybe you're like me. You have a vision of success that guides your dreams and decisions each day. Or maybe you're saying, nope, I'm with Andy. I'm pretty good at just chilling with whatever comes along. But ambition, by definition, is about the future, which means it's about all of us. And as we step into the future, whatever it is we're pursuing, whether it's Mr. Right, the corner office, well-behaved kids, successful ministry, or just a long nap, it matters to God. So does the reason we pursue it. Rescue operation. The ambition dreams I'm talking about can't be unlocked with a surgical procedure. They need to be rescued. To rescue means to save something, to prevent it from being discarded or harmed. Capsized ships need it. Damsels in distress need it. Sometimes our economy needs it. Ambition needs it as well. You see, I believe that ambition, godly ambition that is a noble force for the glory of God. But let's face it, ambition is mostly hovered outside of respectability. For church leaders from Augustine to Jonathan Edwards, ambition was synonymous with the love of earthly honor, vainglory, fame hunting. Pretty slimy stuff. Today's cultural climate doesn't help. The prevailing worldview in the West involves a distrust in big ideas and man's ability to achieve them, and the firm belief that objective truth doesn't exist. But when we deny truth, we suffocate ambition. Without truth as a foundation and ideas worth exploring, meandering replaces meaning, confusion trumps conviction, ambivalence swallows aspiration. Nothing really matters all that much. Ambition must also be rescued from a wrong understanding of humility. That may sound crazy, but I'm serious. I think this issue quenches a lot of evangelical fire. Humility, rightly understood, shouldn't be a fabric softener on our aspirations. When we become too humble to act, we've ceased being biblically humble. True humility doesn't kill our dreams. It provides a guardrail for them, ensuring that they remain on God's road and move in the direction of His glory. Ultimately, it's we ourselves who hold ambition hostage. We're sinners. We love ourselves. We aspire to bring glory to ourselves, and we'll drop godly dreams if something more attractive shows up. And in the process, the right kind of dreams die. So this book is my own little attempt at a rescue operation. The idea is to save ambition, specifically godly ambition, and return it to where it belongs. To do this, we must snatch ambition from the dust heap of failed motivations and put it to work for the glory of God. What about you? Whether you view yourself as a Dave or an Andy, ambitious or laid back, proactive or reactive, type A or type C, whether you're a student, a housewife, executive, politician, or pastor, whether you're staring at a life of opportunities or of limitations, how you relate to ambition will define what you do and who you become far more than you might realize. One way to clarify your spirituality, says Donald Whitney, is to clarify your ambition. I'm not rooting this perspective in common sense or well-researched psychological studies. Nope. Ambition is inherent in who we are before the God who created us. The Bible teaches that people are created by God to desire and to go after those desires with single-minded determination. It's this capacity to desire and strive that can generate remarkable good or stupefying evil. Whether it's to conquer nations or control the remote, we're hardwired to be ambitious for what we want. Why read this book? Read it to make connections between what you want and what you do, between your present opportunities and your future hopes, between your life and God's glory. These connections rescue us from fruitlessness, pointlessness, purposelessness, and the haunting gray twilight of wasted time and lost opportunity. They remind us that a big God uses small people to steer the course of history, people like you and me. To understand ambition, we must understand that each of us lives on a quest for glory. Where we find it determines the success of our quest. And that's where our journey begins.
Chapter 1. Ambition Conceived. We are wired for glory.
Along the River Wye in Wales, there's a little market town known as Hay-on-Wye. This quaint village has earned an international reputation for its rather unusual trade, buying and selling used books. With more than 30 used bookstores within a square mile, one occupying an entire castle, this place embodies storybook charm. My friend Pete, an Irish Englishman living in Wales, frequented the town and its bookshops for years. He arrived each time with a single goal: to excavate the theology sections and unearth an original copy of Lectures to My Students by the great 19th century preacher Charles Spurgeon. But Pete wouldn't settle for just any original copy. He wanted one signed by Spurgeon's wife, Susanna. What's with the signature? This remarkable woman was bedridden for much of her marriage, but somehow managed to start a ministry called the Book Fund. Seeking to serve her husband and their church in the cause of the gospel, Susanna provided free copies of Spurgeon's books to pastors all over the world. Before they went out, she typically personalized them with her own signature. Pete figured a few of these copies had endured a century of use and would eventually turn up in Hay-on-Wye. The keys to their discovery, he told me, were patience, perseverance, and a keen eye. This guy was like Indiana Jones on a used book safari. On a visit with Pete to Hay-on-Wye, I stood in the theology section of a bookshop as my friend recounted his quest to find his treasure. As a first-timer to this holy land of used books, I was just honored to make the pilgrimage. I was also impressed with Pete's dedication. To search for an original edition Spurgeon book is a true measure of theological devotion. But to return to Hay-on-Wye time and time again to rescue a book with a symbolic signature makes its own statement. Here was someone willing to pursue a valued prize with uncommon devotion. There, among the shelves, as Pete chronicled his tale of miles traveled and hours logged in his still fruitless search for Susanna, my vision focused on a book perched on the shelf behind his shoulder. Slipping his gaze for a second, I squinted at the title. Sure enough, staring back at me was a dusty copy of Lectures to My Students. I reached over his shoulder and pulled the book from the shelf. Without interrupting Pete's continuing narration, I flipped open the worn cover and glanced down. You guessed it. In the rookie hands of this Hay-on-Wye greenhorn was an original copy of Lectures to My Students signed by Susanna Spurgeon. A smile crept across my face. Oh boy, this was going to be good. One of my greatest privileges in ministry is working with churches in the United Kingdom. But these mates describe Americans as a bunch of illiterates who sack the English language like a lordless fiefdom. Since I don't know what a lordless fiefdom is, I usually just smile and nod. But right then I knew one thing. In less than 60 seconds, I had nabbed this treasure for which my well-versed Irish-English-Welsh friend had spent years searching. While Pete kept talking, I held out the open cover and said with my best Philadelphian Shakespeare, Yo, dude, is this what you're looking for?
Score one for the Yanks. We chase what we love. What stayed with me most about that experience was not the astounded look on Pete's face, nor the smile as it dawned on him that the treasure was finally in his hands, but the quest itself. Pete wasn't just looking for an old book to add to his collection. He wanted to rescue something that had value beyond appearance, value that connected it to something that mattered to him in a deeply personal way. Pete's story points to something fundamental about each of us. We're pursuers. We go after things we value. What is it for you? Think about what you value. Maybe you can rattle off your priorities like a shopping list. God, marriage, family, work, peace. These often top the charts. But do they actually define how you live? Or are there some bottom-dweller items on the list that actually get headliner attention? If you're not sure, look at how you spend your time, your money. Consider what you think about, where your mind drifts, what you notice and ponder. When all is said and done, what we actually go after is what truly matters to us. Motown captured it in "Ain't No Mountain High Enough." If we love it, no wind, no rain, no winter's cold can stop us. That's just another way to say we all chase what we love. It's something in the way we're wired. Be it books, Broadway, or Botox, we pursue what we value. And what does all of this have to do with Brits in bookstores or pursuing what we value? Good question. Keep reading. Recognizing this impulse isn't a big deal. The trick is getting a handle on how deep it runs and how much it determines what we do. This impulse is so big it can determine how we respond to Jesus himself. A story of glory. John 12 gives us a window into how this human hardwiring works, this impulse to pursue what we value. After Jesus arrives for the final time in Jerusalem, the scene that quickly unfolds is pivotal in the drama of redemption. He's the center of attention, everybody's attention. In the middle of it all, Jesus prays, "Father, glorify your name." Immediately a response booms out. Then a voice came from heaven, "I have glorified it, and I will glorify it again." Verse 28. A voice from heaven. When was the last time you heard someone's prayers get answered at once with the audible voice of God? One would expect this episode would permanently turn all the bystanders into Christ followers, right? Not exactly. John goes on to tell us something shocking. Though he had done so many signs before them, they still did not believe in him. Verse 37. Surprised to hear the people could be with him and hear God speak to him and still not believe? It gets worse. There were others who did believe, yet still wouldn't follow. Many even of the authorities believed in him, but for fear of the Pharisees, they did not confess it. Verse 42. Let's track this. They listened to him, they believed in him, but they wouldn't say so publicly. How come? What was so important that they could look straight at the Son of God and turn away? John says it was for fear of the Pharisees. After all, these so-called believers were authorities in the Jewish community, which meant their jobs and reputations were tied to synagogue life, and the Pharisees could put them out of the synagogue. To be bounced from the synagogue meant you could kiss your position and your income goodbye. That's pretty serious. Before we judge them too severely, though, think about whether your own conversion carried any fear of reprisals. My decision to follow Jesus was a response to an altar call. Several, actually. The possibility of being expelled from my neighborhood was inconceivable, although there were certainly incidents at school where expulsion seemed possible. If the fear those Jerusalem authorities felt was anything like mine during those episodes, I'm sure they were freaked out. But here's the grabber. In the very next sentence, God restrains our instinctive sympathy for these guys by flipping the light on their true motives. Why the hypocrisy? Was it something they feared? Yes, at first glance. But deep inside, it was really something they loved. They loved the glory that comes from man, John writes, more than the glory that comes from God, verse 43. Glory. They craved it. They were addicted to it. Their drive was so powerful, it diverted them from the Son of God himself. We're glory chasers. John is offering us amazing insight into the way we tick. We love glory. We were created to look for it and to love it when we find it. A lot of glory is being promised and delivered in this section of Scripture. The idea of glory occurs at least 7 times in John 12. Glory also remains a significant theme for the remainder of John's Gospel. John wants us to understand that everyone in this scene, including Jesus himself, is pursuing something, and that something is glory. What is glory? The New Testament word, doxa, speaks of worth and dignity and weight. It's most often applied to God, but also includes man. Glory is about radiance and splendor. But glory isn't just an attribute. It exists to be seen and recognized. It's about reputation, esteem, standing, honor. At its core, glory is about inherent value that's recognizable to others. It draws attention. Like a magnet, the value of glory attracts us. The Bible presents us with a God who is glorious in himself and whose glory is recognized and acknowledged. In a profound sense, this glorious God created the cosmos to display his glory, his worth, his value. To whom? To a special creature who could take it in, make some sense of it, and rejoice over the worth of his creator. To us. That's what the Bible means when it calls us to glorify God. We can't make him something he already is, glorious, but we can recognize the glory that radiates from him, value it properly, and give God his due. That's why we were created. The Westminster Divines understood this. Man's chief end, they said, is tied to our glory instinct. It's to glorify God and enjoy him forever. You've probably heard of storm chasers. They are people who dedicate their lives to running after storms, even at great risk to themselves. If a tornado is barreling down on some Midwestern town, these lunatics are speeding up the road to catch it. They're in pursuit of this spectacular force of nature. Maybe you don't chase tornadoes, but we're all born glory chasers. Glory moments stir us. Think about what prompts your elation. Your favorite team wins the championship. You read about a blind man climbing Mount Everest. You watch an Olympic gymnast dismounting flawlessly to grab the gold. You learn that Beethoven would sit down and improvise pieces at the piano that witnesses swear were finer than his written compositions. You hear the story again of Wilberforce prevailing over Parliament to end the slave trade. We're awed by great comebacks, heroic efforts, sacrificial endurance, and extraordinary gifts. Glory arrests our attention. My friend Paul Tripp describes us as glory junkies. He says, admit it, you're a glory junkie. That's why you like the 360-degree between-the-legs slam dunk, or that amazing hand-beaded formal gown, or the 7-layer triple chocolate mousse cake. It's why you're attracted to the hugeness of a mountain range or the multi-hued splendor of the sunset. You were hardwired by your Creator for a glory orientation. It is inescapable. It's in your genes. Glory grabs us. But even more than that, it arouses something in our souls. It stirs us. We experience something totally vicarious, some strange exercise in identification. And make no mistake, it goes deep. It calls to something we value, to do something that matters, to seek something greater than our own puny existence. It's an instinct for glory. It pops up in a stark contrast Paul portrays in Romans between two groups of seekers. On one side are those who by patience in well-doing seek for glory and honor and immortality. On the other side, those who are self-seeking. To the first group, God will give eternal life. For the second, there will be wrath and fury. Romans chapter 2, verses 6 through 8. Try to wrap your brain around this. God doesn't oppose glory seeking. He commends it. And what's more astounding, He rewards it with eternal life. But there's a condition. We must seek a certain type of glory. We're to hunger, crave, earnestly desire, to be ambitious for the glory that comes from God. So where do we discover it? Growing up, my next-door neighbor had a swimming pool. This was before the idea of a pool in every backyard was invented. This pool was awesome in how it attracted children. I mean, kids bust in all the way from Idaho just to have a swim. Pools had that effect back then. They gathered kids into one place. If we want the glory that comes from God, we must begin at the place where it gathered. This glory is a person. I was converted in college sometime around 1979. I've met people who know the day and hour of their conversion, their spiritual birthday. That's cool. But it didn't happen that way for me. God's grace was ultimately irresistible, but I can be pretty stubborn, so I resisted to the point of exhaustion. I think fatigue played a prominent role in my conversion. It's probably why I don't remember when I became a Christian. But there are memories I treasure from that time, all of them centering on a surprising joy in becoming captivated with the person of Jesus. Reading the Gospels was a life-transforming experience, seeing His holiness, His love, His miracles, His kindness. It was entrancing. Jesus wasn't theoretical or abstract, like the logic class I was finding totally illogical. He was amazing, real, alive, and accessible. Before, I used to think, if God would just appear to me in glory, I could finally believe. He did appear. Jesus Christ is the glory that comes from God. Loving this glory that comes from God means first savoring the one who personified God's glory, Jesus Christ. Glory isn't simply a quality of Christ. Jane has a nice smile. Ronnie's tall. And oh, by the way, Jesus has glory. No, Jesus embodies the glory of God. He literally is the glory that comes from God. This is why, in opening his gospel, John leaves no doubt that glory is on his mind. The Word became flesh and dwelt among us, and we have seen his glory, glory as of the only Son from the Father, full of grace and truth. John 1, verse 14. John later notes that even Isaiah saw the glory of Jesus and testified of him. Paul and James both call Jesus the Lord of glory, 1 Corinthians 2, verse 8, James chapter 2, verse 1. Paul speaks eloquently of the glory of God in the face of Jesus Christ, 2 Corinthians chapter 4, verse 6. And the writer of Hebrews says of him, He is the radiance of the glory of God, Hebrews 1, verse 3. God's glory, His honor, His esteem, His mind-blowing perfection, His incomprehensible value is embodied in flesh and blood in the person of Jesus Christ. This is where God's glory gathers. To love the glory that comes from God means we love the person of Jesus Christ. To love Christ means we value Him more than anything else. This is the defining characteristic of Christian conversion. We love the Savior and want to live for His glory. We want to follow Him, obey Him, trust Him, and proclaim Him. But loving the glory that comes from God isn't just an emotional attraction for Jesus. These days, spirituality is trending positive, and Jesus is considered pretty hip. But you can have good feelings about Jesus and be far from His glory. To love God's glory means connecting Jesus, the person of God's glory, to Calvary, the summit of God's glory. Remember when Jesus prayed in John 12, Father, glorify your name? Heaven's response was twofold. I have glorified it, God said, testifying to the fact that His glory is incarnate in the Son. But the father didn't stop there. He continued, I will glorify it again. When would the father glorify his own name again? He was speaking of the atoning death Jesus was anticipating at that very moment. We know this because Jesus immediately explained it to his listeners. He said, And I, when I am lifted up from the earth, will draw all people to myself. John follows up to make sure we get it. He said this, John explains, to show by what kind of death he was going to die. John chapter 12, verses 32 and 33. God's magnificence, the magnetic power of his glory, was on full display at the summit of Calvary. God was most glorified when the Lord of glory was crucified on the cross. As John Stott writes, the gospel is Christ crucified, his finished work on the cross. And to preach the gospel is publicly to portray Christ as crucified. The gospel is not good news primarily of a baby in a manger, a young man at a carpenter's bench, a preacher in the fields of Galilee, or even an empty tomb. The gospel concerns Christ upon his cross. Only when Christ is openly displayed upon his cross is the gospel preached. Contemplating the cross, we're left to stand and wonder at this chilling spectacle. The Lord of glory hung upon a cross of shame. Bearing the wrath we deserved, God displayed his love so that he might be just and the justifier of the one who has faith in Jesus. Romans chapter 3, verse 26. On the wings of this remarkable, incomprehensible historical event, God's glory soared ad infinitum. The cross is amazing because it aligns our mind and heart to the right direction. It's there that we discover the pinnacle of God's glory in the person and work of Jesus Christ. To trust this redemptive act of love as sufficient to save us is the defining step toward loving the glory that comes from God. But there's something else. As a new Christian, something happened deep inside of me. My motivation was converted. Grace ignited godly ambition. Ambivalence was replaced with aspiration. I went from thinking apathy was cool to itching to show my faith by my works. Literally. At one time, God wasn't even on my radar. Now I wanted God to use my life to make a difference. Why? Because to be born again is to be given a fresh start, to be propelled out of an old life into the adventure of new ambition. Jonathan Edwards called it a holy ardency and vigor in the actings of grace. Spurgeon pictures it this way in a sermon on being a good soldier of Christ Jesus. The true soldier is an ambitious being. He pants for honor, seeks for glory. On the field of strife, he gathers his laurels, and amidst a thousand dangers, he reaps renown. The Christian is fired by higher ambitions than any earthly warrior ever knew. He sees a crown that can never fade. He loves a king who, best of all, is worthy to be served. He has a motive within him which moves him to the noble deeds, a divine spirit impelling him to the most self-sacrificing actions. Grace fires the soul and makes us want to live for the only glory that matters. But too often, even after our conversion, in spite of the magnificence of this glory that emanates from God and centers on the cross, we love man-made glory instead. We follow the choice the Jewish authorities made, to love glory from man rather than glory from God. As John paints this scene for us, what he's bringing to light and what is absolutely crucial to our understanding of ambition is that we will always pursue glory. The only question is, where will we find it? Will we love the glory that comes from God, or will we love other glories? Jesus asks all of us, how can you believe when you receive glory from one another and do not seek the glory that comes from the only God? John chapter 5, verse 44. The stakes are high. Ambivalence toward Christ actually means we're rejecting the glory that comes from God in pursuit of something counterfeit. The authorities and Pharisees provide a stunning reminder that one can be sincerely religious and still chase bogus glory. How about you? You may be searching for glory in dozens of places, but have you found the only glory that lasts? This glory demands a pursuit. How does this hardwired glory instinct create ambition? It works like this. To love glory is to pursue glory. If we love the glory that comes from God, it translates into a lifelong, passionate, zealous quest. In other words, godly ambition. God's love is always seen in His action. For God so loved the world that He gave His only Son, John 3:16. God loved us, so He came after us in Christ. It's the same with us. If I say to my wife, Kim, I love you, but I don't pursue her, things will get awfully chilly around the Harvey house. The depth of my love is seen in the intensity of my pursuit. I once saw an advertisement for the Olympic Games that featured a picture of a runner perched on his mark. Sweat crowned his forehead, intensity filling his unblinking eyes, and his muscles were taut, ready to detonate at the sound of the gun. Beneath the picture was this caption: He's waited his entire life for the next 10 seconds. What motivates Olympic athletes to train for years for one event? In some cases, for just seconds of actual competition. It's the same thing that kept my friend Pete nosing around old bookstores for years. It's the same thing that makes a person venture out of a comfortable job to start a new business. We see it in the artist who spends day after day in a studio chipping away at a block of stone. Look closely and you'll find it in the shopper who passes up the good deal in search of the best deal. It's one of the things that makes us most human. We consciously pursue what we value. It's not simply a matter of being driven by biology or genetics or environmental conditioning to satisfy instinctive cravings. Rather, we perceive something, prize it at a certain value, then pursue it according to that assigned value because we were created that way. This ability to perceive, prize, and pursue is part of our essential humanness, and it's the essence of ambition. Before we'll see godly ambition as worth rescuing, we need to rediscover its value. Simply put, if we understand ambition as God intends it, we'll see how valuable it is and why it's worth the storm chaser-like devotion to rescue it. So let's explore how ambition works. Ambition perceives. The seeds of ambition are sown when we perceive value. Something seems worthy of our attention. It attracts us. Value is alluring. Our curiosity comes alive. I once visited the Tower of London and saw the crown jewels. They were, well, wow. Magnificent. Incredible. As my kids would have said, splendiferous. Naturally, I just had to get a price check. So, what are they worth? I asked the guard standing there. With absolutely no eye contact, yet speaking loudly enough for all England to hear, he announced, "Priceless, sir." I figured he thought I was deaf. In reality, he knew I was dumb. And dumb rarely gets it. Assuming he didn't understand me the first time, I spoke again. "No, I mean, what are they worth?" Adding volume always helps. "You know, street value." He must live for these moments. Some fresh, dumb tourist jokes he can trade at the local pub. Still making no eye contact, he announced even louder, "Priceless, sir." The second time I got the translation. "You're not worth eye contact, you dumb yank. Don't you understand what you're looking at?" Okay, so call me clueless. I walked away a little embarrassed, but even more impressed. In his irritatingly smarmy way, the guard was helping me perceive the value beyond what I was seeing. Perceiving true value is the starting point for godly ambition. We'll never be ambitious for what we don't value. We must perceive God's glory as infinitely more precious than the crown jewels. This isn't easy, because we live in a world that throws a lot of things in our face that appear glorious, wealth, reputation, success, things we'll talk about in upcoming chapters. Our hearts love to look for glory in the wrong places. But perceiving true value in God's glory isn't just important, it's priceless, sir. Ambition prizes. Perceiving worth is an important start, but it rarely converts into ambition unless we personally prize what we perceive. We not only perceive worth in something, but we set our desires to possess it. Our affections follow our perception. Few of us wake up each morning ambitious for exercise. It's also not enough to perceive its value. We can, after all, objectively value exercise but live a couch potato life. For exercise to make a difference, we must prize it as good for us. Ambitions rise to what we prize. If you perceive exercise as good, you'll admire people who do it. If you prize exercise, you'll rise to do it yourself. A few years ago, a university in Philadelphia owned a well-known painting by artist Thomas Eakins called The Gross Clinic. It was so named because it depicts a famous 19th-century Philadelphia surgeon, a Dr. Gross, I'm serious, performing surgery on a patient's leg. Seeing this graphic painting, you might think it's called The Gross Clinic for a more obvious reason. Nevertheless, it's considered a masterpiece of American art and a treasure of Philadelphia history. But the university was strapped for cash and agreed to sell the painting to two museums in another part of the country. After much civic outrage and a remarkable public and private fundraising campaign, our two most prominent local museums jointly purchased the painting for more than it was worth on the open market. Why? Because this painting was deemed to have a value to this city that made it worth more to us than simply its value on the market. As they say in the art world, it was a prized work of art. Ambition is willing to pay more than full price if that's what it takes. And whether it's God or golf clubs or a painting of Dr. Gross, we always pursue what we prize. Ambition pursues. There are always things we might value, things we can make an effort to obtain. But ambition isn't just being in the market for something. Ambition is prizing something so much that we go after it. We're willing to sacrifice to get it. The value I personally assign to it creates motivation and moves me to take action to obtain it. God is pleased when we prize and pursue the right things. As the ancient church patriarch Clement said, it will not be pleasing to God himself if we value least those things which are worth most. That's why we're called to hunger and thirst for righteousness, Matthew chapter 5, verse 6, and to seek first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, Matthew chapter 6, verse 33. Prizing what is of eternal value stirs ambitions to pursue those things. In Matthew 13, Jesus illustrates the inestimable worth of the kingdom of God with a couple of little parables. The kingdom of heaven is like treasure hidden in a field, which a man found and covered up. Then in his joy he goes and sells all that he has and buys that field. Again, the kingdom of heaven is like a merchant in search of fine pearls, who, on finding one pearl of great value, went and sold all that he had and bought it. Matthew chapter 13, verses 44 through 46. What's the link between these two? Both describe something of obviously immense worth, and both describe an unabashed, aggressive, go for it with everything you've got pursuit of prized objects. Jesus is teaching that some things are so valuable they're worth spending and being spent to acquire. Paul shows us what it is that's so worthy. I count everything as loss because of the surpassing worth of knowing Christ Jesus my Lord, he tells us. For his sake I have suffered the loss of all things, Philippians chapter 3, verse 8. He's referring to all that once defined him, his people, his education, his godliness under the law, his religious zeal. These cultural crowns of ancestry and accomplishments, Paul declares, are only a big zero compared to knowing Christ. This in turn drives Paul to go after what he prizes with all he has. I press on toward the goal for the prize of the upward call of God in Christ Jesus. Philippians 3, verse 14. Pursuing Christ isn't about withdrawing to a cave somewhere so we can contemplate his grandeur. Pursuit means passion, purpose, and action. It's always moving forward, like Paul. He told the Romans, "From Jerusalem and all the way around to Illyricum, I have fulfilled the ministry of the gospel of Christ." Knowing his work had ended in those places, he was ambitious to see the gospel advance to new areas. "And thus, I make it my ambition to preach the gospel, not where Christ has already been named, lest I build on someone else's foundation." Romans 15, verses 19 and 20. Godly ambition is like that. A completed job isn't a completed life. There are new fields, new ideas, new innovations, new songs, new ways to glorify God. Connections. "Dave, you don't understand." I can hear you saying, "I'm not like Paul or Peter or Joan of Arc or any other go-getter, do-gooder, bigger-than-life characters that fill the pages of history. I don't even like history. I don't need to be always doing or thinking. I enjoy just being."
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.